what are appropriate position operators, and connected to with that Manavan's theorem, and also the question, how do you ontologically understand how to creation and relation? Then the problem of consistent relativistic interactions related to ultraviolet divergence in quantum field theories, and so on. So you see there will be a lot of issues more coming up in quantum field theory, all in addition to the usual ones, to the measurement problem, to non-locality, to contextuality, to all of them. Here I will just focus on one question that Rory already mentioned, namely, can the non-locality of quantum mechanics be reconciled with relativity? And if so, how? And if not fully, to which extent? And we'll discuss that for the different theories we have studied here. Actually, to even address this question precisely, one needs a precise version of quantum mechanics, which is free of the measurement problem. Otherwise, you cannot really definitely answer how something can be reconciled if you don't have a consistent theory. All right, so the outline for today is, first I will speak about multi-time wave functions, which is a certain type of concept of a relativistic wave function that we will just need for all of the, to unfold all of the further theories in this talk. And anyway, it's something nice to know to make a little bit of advertisement for my research topic. Briefly say, and it's actually not very difficult how to extend the manifold interpretation using such a multi-time wave function to relativity. Then a little bit more difficult is how to construct a relativistic version of GWF. So GW, the collapse theory, the flash ontology. That is an extension of what Rody presented, and actually also due to Rody. So it's a major contribution of Rody to foundation of relativistic quantum theory. And finally, I will speak about how Bohmian mechanics can, get a relativistic version of Bohmian mechanics, the so-called hypersurface Bohm-Dirac model, and I will also compare these different theories a little bit. All right, so let's start with multi-time wave functions. But in a relativistic situation, so is the idea, the basic object of quantum mechanics, the wave function, should also be a Lorentz covariant object. For a single particle, this is nicely achieved by the Dirac equation, which I've written here. I gamma mu d mu minus m acting on psi of x equals 0. X is your element of space-time. These gammas matrices, the matrices, 4x4 matrices, a certain ones with the, which satisfy special relations, such that this equation will really be the Lorentz covariant. And d mu is the derivative with respect to the mu coordinate of x. Under a Lorentz transformation, psi will transform to a different psi prime, and its functional expression is also given by some matrix that, depending on the Lorentz transformation lambda, times psi of lambda inverse x. So what is important here is that we have a certain matrix in front, and these matrices as of lambda, also 4x4 matrices, and matrices which form a spinor representation of the Lorentz group. So this is kind of a well-known theory of the Dirac equation in relativistic quantum mechanics. The crucial point, however, is that if we go to many particles, the wave function which we would be used to, psi of t, just one t, well, this, of course, this contains the tx, yeah? T being just one coordinate, and x being a three vector. So these x's here are three vectors, but for many particles, you just still have just one time and n space variables. And such a function cannot be a Lorentz covariant object. So you simply don't know how to transform something which doesn't have a pure space-time form. It's so unclear how to deform a function of one time variable and many space variables. Maybe I should draw a little picture here. If you look at this, the argument of psi, of course, does contain space-time information. So if you draw a space-time diagram, then we could just enter the information interpretation, a very kind of very little interpretation into a space-time diagram, and he's saying that these are n space-time points, but at the same time t. So we regard this thing as physically synonymous to the collection of space-time points, where we add just the same time coordinate for each part. Alright? So then we can enter it in a space-time diagram. So this is a t equals constant slice of space-time, and we would then have n space-time points here. So these space-time points are these coordinates. Alright. And so we can, of course, Lorentz transform these in a different frame. So let me draw a different frame with a different color. A different frame would axis like that, x prime and t prime. And if you now read off the coordinates, we can do that by just taking the parallel lines. You see that the time coordinates will come all different. So that would be the t1 prime coordinate, t2 prime coordinate, and so on. So after Lorentz transformation, the new coordinates won't be simultaneous anymore. So what should we do? Well, I guess we should have a wave function which also lives on arbitrary, at least space-like space-time configurations. And that is the idea of multi-time wave functions. So it actually is due to Dirac and was further taken up also by Tomonaga and Springer, who are really famous. I mean, all of them are Nobel Prize winners. So the idea here is that the wave function psi that we are used to from Schrodinger's equation of non-relativistic quantum mechanics is just a special case of a more general object, phi, the multi-time wave function. It lives in space-time configuration, and well, which special case is it? Well, just those when all these time coordinates are equal to each other in a certain frame. So this is a frame-dependent object. Well, this is in general not, but I've just chosen here a particular frame to make this connection. The basic object, so to summarize, is a multi-time wave function. It lives on perhaps a certain subset of space-time, but a configuration space-time takes a configuration space-time vector, maps it to some spin space vector, or just let's say a complex vector. So it will take these things, map it to a value in the spin space. And the natural domain for a multi-time wave function are the space-like configurations. In that case, that would mean something like points elsewhere in space, but you don't not really say at a certain time, which is kind of somewhere elsewhere in space. That's the kind of most general notion of a configuration in relativity, an element of the space-like configurations. Yes?
So do you require that those t's can be moved Lorentz transformed back to a single t for all of them, or do you?
No, I don't require that.
You don't. Okay.
Mm-hmm. It'd also be a really natural notion to have a wave function just in kind of all those kind of collinear space-like points. Okay. But I take it also with like kind like a sight on with a kind of glass on general relativity. I take it to be all space-like. So an element of these doesn't have to be simultaneous in any frame, but it's a little bit more general than taking all the frames. But for two particles, for example, would be exactly the same. All right. So that is the basic object. The next question that occurs is, how does something which contains n time variables evolve, or what kind of equation does it obey? And the most simple idea that one could have, or most straightforward idea, is due to Dirac, that one should have a system of n wave equations one for each parabola, one for each time. Meaning that the multi-time wave function phi has to satisfy a Schrödinger-like equation in each of the time variables, but it has to satisfy simultaneously n of these equations. So they develop Hamiltonian form. And HK is supposed to be differential operators called partial Hamiltonians, as opposed to being, let's say, integral operators. And also, I mean, I will write this in a Hamiltonian form, but I mean, this doesn't look very characteristically invariant, but I suppose that you can rewrite it. I've also given an example in a covariant form. Of course, we are aiming at Lorentz covariant wave equations. And there's some mathematical facts about this. It's not so easy to solve a system of n simultaneous partial differential equations. It's not always possible. But so solving would mean that you get initial data where, well, simply where, sorry, I wrote this not so well. So it should be like t1 equals 0 up to tn equals 0. So you give the function, let's say, where all times are equal to 0, or more generally on any kind of space-like surface to be n. So if you have a space-like surface to be n, and then to be n, you give the function there, restricted to that surface, then you just give its value. Why should you do that? Well, you would know from this correspondence with a single time wave function. So, for example, you would like to solve Schrödinger's equation by giving the wave function a time equals 0, and would here translate to all times equals 0. And then, of course, you can generalize it a bit to any space that surface to the end. All right, so when can we solve this system for all initial data of that type? Well, the answer turns out to be, and that's the so-called consistency condition, if this commutator here is satisfied for all j unequal to k. So let's say these hk operators are actually time independent. If they are, that just would just mean that they have to commute. So it means something like, if you go a little bit in this one time direction to evolve the function, and then go in another time direction, it is the same as if you went in the second first and then in the first. Yeah? So it's a certain kind of commutative diagram that has to be satisfied here. All right, so this is a mathematical fact about when such equations are solvable. And another question that certainly occurs is, what does it have to do with the usual Schrödinger equation? And well, if we have such a system of equations satisfied, then we can use the chain rule and the multi-time equations to show the following. Well, let's go through it slowly. We take here the multi-time wave function and look at it at equal times. So that would correspond to the non-relativistic wave function. And then we take the IDT of that. And what we will see is, well, by the chain rule, we have to take the derivative with each of the times and then later set them all equal. And that leads to, by using the multi-time equations, that we get the sum of these partial Hamiltonians acting on phi itself. Yes, Jean?
But does that mean that your total Hamiltonian is not interacting between the
particles? It doesn't have to mean that, no. So you could have, for example, in each of the partial Hamiltonians already a potential.
But not a potential coming from the other particles?
In principle, it could be.
Ah, okay.
It turns out that a lot of these possibilities don't actually work, but some, for example, delta potentials do actually work.
Okay.
Yeah, it's not easy to get this interacting, but it's not impossible. But yeah, but it's true that a lot of interaction potentials would not work. But you can't actually see it so well just from that.
No.
So here you could, for example, if you have, let's say you have just two particles, and then you say H1 is equal to the Dirac Hamiltonian to maybe 1/2. And then for the second, choose the same potential here, so that would just lead to a Schrödinger equation. Mm. I mean, where you would have just the normal potential image. I mean, a lot of these possibilities won't work, but because of this consistency condition, but not because of this critical. Yeah, it's actually a big question how to get interaction into these equations, but it's just a kind of separate question from the points I want to make in this talk. Actually, my research is very much concerned with the question how to get interaction into these equations, but it's not so relevant here. But in certain cases, they actually do. No. For example, if there's a delta function. So if these potentials are delta functions, you can actually make that work now. But it also has to do with the fact that you want to solve this only in space-like configuration. And then those points where the delta function actually gives a contribution is not really part of the state. But okay, so that's a separate issue. Let me now give an example, and I will for these difficulties, I will here focus on the case that we have non-interacting equations. Non-interacting is still not trivial because they could still be entangled wave functions. So for our purposes, for non-locality, that's fine. We don't have to know where the entanglement came from as supposedly from some interaction. But if you just want to study the consequence of non-locality, then it's enough to just have a look at entanglement. But it's still important to have a Lorentz covariant wave equation. And so an example for that would be just if you choose three multi-time Dirac equations, meaning that in each variable, x1 to xn, and the corresponding spin index, we have a Dirac equation satisfied. And these would be kind of trivially compatible because they act on just completely different variables. And there this commutation condition would be satisfied. All right, so yeah, this just reflects of a direct equation each variable. And then you get this abbreviation, I will sometimes use that. Gamma mu k is the mu matrix from the direct equation. And then you have that only act on the k spin index and as the identity of the other spin index. Alright. So if you have multi-time equations, you can look at the conservation laws, the local conservation laws they imply. The multi-time Dirac equations actually do imply an interesting conservation law. Namely, if you take this quantity here that's written here, so it is a phi bar, meaning phi bar means take the Hermitian conjugate and then multiply with all the gamma zero matrices, so similar to what you would do in the Dirac equation. And you sandwich between psi bar and psi, you sandwich all these different gamma matrices. It's sometimes a tensor product of n gamma matrices acting on different indices. And then you will have that each of them satisfies a continuity equation. This object satisfies a continuity equation in each index. Okay. So you identify this object, give it a name. J phi, so meaning the kind of tensor current coming from the wave function phi, and there's an object with n indices, depending on n space time. From that, you can make a natural guess what probability density you would associate, similarly to the Born rule, but now to a curved surface in space time. So, again, consider space time. Or equal time surface would be something like that. But we can also consider more general surfaces. First of all, of course, surfaces, equal time surfaces of different frames. But then also curved surfaces. And I call these curved space-like surfaces sigma. And given such a multi-time tensor current, you can make a natural guess what the probability density would be. I mean, we don't know there is one yet that needs further justification, but we can still make a guess, like the Born rule is a guess for what the probability density would be, and you can give certain justifications for it. So we define rho sigma as meaning the probability density along the space-like surface sigma is given by the tensor current and contracted with the normal vector field n at all these points where you look at. So in the picture, you have the space-like surface sigma, you have the normal vector field x at that surface, and then when you look at n space-time points, you look at all these different vectors here and contract it with the tensor current. Okay, that's the kind of a natural mathematical expression you might guess for space-like Lakatos surface. An interesting fact, of course, we should check is that it agrees with the normal psi squared and density field of a flat surface, and let's do that maybe. So, for this flat surface, the normal vector field will just be upward pointing time direction. It will be just a 1, 0, 0, 0 vector everywhere. So that means rho sigma, we could write this as rho sigma t equals constant, an equal time plane is equal to, and then we will contract this j mu 1 to mu n just with this vector just pointing in this direction, so we will just get a 0, 0, 0, 0 component. And but we have to recall what that was. This was a phi bar, gamma 1, 0 to gamma n, 0, phi. And that is phi dagger, gamma 1, 0 square up to gamma n 0 square phi. And well, these gammas, they just have the gamma zeros just have the property. When you either know that or have to believe me, that they square to the identity matrix. So it will be phi dagger phi, which is equal to phi square. And then you can sense of complex numbers or complex factors. Alright, so you see really this reduces to the phi square density for the case of surface where no one otherwise generalizes it in a covariant or natural expression. So that would be kind of a natural guess for what the probability density is along a curved surface. Then also, as a like consequence of the continuity equation we had before, actually the integral of that density along a space-like surface to the n is conserved, meaning that this quantity, this integral, is almost the same, never mind which space-like surface you look at. And that corresponds to total probability conservation. All these facts together suggest to guess a generalized Born rule, namely that sigma be a space-like Lakatos surface. Then rho sigma of x1 to xn, d sigma of x1 up to d sigma of xn. These are three-dimensional volume elements around these infinitesimal three-dimensional volume elements along this surface. And that quantity here is the probability to detect n particles in the infinitesimal three volumes, sigma d sigma of xk around sigma xk, so points in the space-like surface for all these indices. So roughly the picture is if you want to know where to detect on sigma like certain particles, you would look up this density quantity along these points. Maybe otherwise, at least in the Bohmian theory, you would imagine, only in the Bohmian theory, would imagine that really you have actually maybe world lines which you might detect along that surface. But we come to that. Alright, but otherwise just don't think about trajectories, just think about the probability to detect certain particles, whatever your interpretation is. Alright. Of course, we have to know this rule is still associated, as usual, like the Born rule is with the measurement problem. We need actually a justification for the rule by a relativistic theory, which is free of the measurement. We will come to such theories now. let us start with a relativistic version of the many roles interpretation. I start with that because it's actually easiest to make one. I discuss only a very simple version for, and it's probably not the only version of such a theory one can discuss. And sometimes I just discuss a particular very simple model that shows how we could set up such an interpretation. I'm also not doing that for quantum field theory, but for a fixed number of particles. You imagine like simply processes where particle creation and emission is not relevant, but still maybe their relativistic movement is important. And these also non-interacting but entangled, corresponding to these equations that are the three multi-time derivative equations that we just saw. So the basic ingredients are, first, the multi-time wave function satisfying the equation we had before, the three multi-time derivative equation. Alright? And then second, I mean, maybe Lev doesn't like it, but I think it's still kind of important to make clear what we're thinking about. Maybe we take now, again, a meta-density function, like ensuring as many roles. And this meta-density function is a little bit different than from before. It's just kind of a covariant version of that we had before. So first of all, you see it has an index, so it's a vector-valued meta-density function. Which, well, I guess you could have that. It's not really a problem to consider. We have a sum over certain terms that are weighted with the masses. And then what we will do is essentially...
Rest masses?
Yes, I would say so. But any parameters, I mean, I guess that even call these masses is makes the phrase maybe some analysis,
this
some parameters.
This was exactly my point. Don't put it, just use this expression without call it mass density. Just
no, but I think we'll, by our analysis we will find out and then it behaves really like a mass density. Anyway.
It's a wave function density.
Yeah, fine, you can call it like that.
Well, mass is...
Well, so I think it's still kind of important to get clear what you're talking about in space. But maybe you feel like it's already clear to you just having a multi-time wave function, maybe it's not clear to other people. Maybe it's also not so clear to you if you just have a multi-time wave function, because the multi-time aspect is not a little bit new.
Multi-time, use all the time as well.
Okay, good. But a very different multi-time version.
Not very.
Okay, all right. But okay, so I still need to explain how that works. But previously we had a three-dimensional integral. So now we have three-dimensional integrals that are replaced by also three-dimensional integrals, but along these curved surfaces. So we have surface integrals, so three-dimensional surfaces in Minkowski space-time, instead of just integrals over three-dimensional space, which here would correspond to equal time hyperplane. But this is kind of the general version of what would make meant a space at a certain time. And then we leave out, before I think Rodi wrote this with a delta function, so we leave out one of them, and this one of them, we essentially integrate the density which we have, but we leave also one of these contractions. And so this index is the one that appears here, and that x here is that, and essentially it's like taking the margin of integrating all of the other degrees of freedom from that thing that otherwise generates you the density. And that you take as a mass density. Alright. Then I guess one can say the theory works in the usual way. There's not much new to say about it, but really it works in a way that also the mass density and all the facts that you would say about all these worlds would be covariant, because this mass density is constructed in a covariant way. But how is the non-locality implemented? It's just intrinsic in the wave function. It's a non-local object which determines the meta density. And the status with respect to relativity is that it is compatible without additional problems, without any additional questions that are already present in the non-relativistic many worlds. Note also that multi-time wave functions are very useful to achieve this compatibility with relativity. Maybe it's not the only way, but it's certainly a nice way. All right, so I think that's what I have to say about the relativistic many worlds interpretation. I mean, there would be a lot of more detailed questions, I guess, but just to see if it could be done, so I guess we have seen. Yes?
Just a quick question. What's the difference between action at a distance and non-local in this context?
I think action at distance implies more. Implies more like a control over things. So it's usually if you have the feeling it's something like a wiggle here and like something like space like separated, but also wiggle there. It's not this control is not necessarily there.
Yeah. And how would you define a non-local object then? Because to my mind, that
non-locality
is.
A non-local object is like the
then
wave function is already a non-local object.
Yeah, but like, what do you mean by a non-local object? Because I always thought of non-locality in terms of action at a distance.
Ah, so this is like something that the facts in the world are kind of already described in a way that you've described these facts as space-like relation all together.
Maybe it's helpful to say the following. For action at a distance, you usually mean, oh, an agent does something on one side, and something will... some effect will take place on the other side. For non-locality, you could also have non-controllable events, random events that take place on one side and influence other events on the other side, but no agent was involved. Actually, something like that will happen with GRW, so maybe if you wait a little longer, then you will see an example of that with GRW.
May I just comment? I would say the non-locality without the section of the distance, if you cannot describe the whole story as a sum of local story, then the story is non-local, and many words is like this. But no influence of any type of whatsoever cannot you do something here, nothing whatsoever will happen there. I don't accept this as a random or not random or whatever.
Yeah, thank you for these clarifications. All right, so then are there further questions about many words? Otherwise, I will come to the relativistic version of GRWF. This model is actually due to Rolle. The basic ingredients are, first, we use, again, the same law for the Marsh-Tang wave function. We will use that law just to compare like something similar models for all these equations. It is though here, it's not exactly the right equation. This equation will be from time to time interrupted by a stochastic process, as the GRW theory does, by collapses. And by random collapses, which at the same time as a rock collapses means like something's done to the wave function. And they also generate flashes. They generate events that actually we speak about that the world consists of, and these are kind of certain events in space. I will show more pictures about that. And these flashes are also the collapse centers, so those parts.
It's not the other way around. I thought the flashes generate collapses.
Okay, I think this is a. Yeah, all right. Yeah, doesn't really matter. So, how we imagine the world to be in GRWF theory is that we consider space time, here time, here space axis, and the things that are there are just discrete events, point-like discrete events in space-time, shown here. These are called flashes. And objects are galaxies of flashes. So these are the two lumps of matter. So Rudy, I think, described in his talks as two, maybe they could see if these are really many, two kind of stars or two lumps of matter, which kind of circle each other. And you have to see the motion is somewhat hidden in this, of course, in this time axis. It's a static picture in space-time, but of course there's motion just by having the time axis in there. So that's how we imagine space. And interestingly, of course, if you take any slice through it, they generate, like, normally you would just miss all of them, yeah? So you really have to look at space-time to understand what's happening in GRWF theory. It's not helpful to take slices through space-time in that theory. Okay, so now we come to the law. Well, please bear with me. It's a small story, we try to go through it at one step at a time and precisely. So we imagine that somewhere at the beginning we have n flashes from which we start. So we will kind of set this up, this picture, by starting from n star flashes, and we will generate then And the next type n flash, we set up this picture kind of step by step. Give a certain algorithm of the previous. We start with n seed flashes. And then we will do the following. We determine n time differences, and in which like a time-like distance we want to put new flashes. And how we do that, well, these we select at random, how long you need to wait until you get the next flash. And this waiting, well, like just give a time would mean to do something bound to one frame. So we select actually time-like distances, and how we implement that is, well, if you have a like starting flash and want to put the next flash, you want to put it, so to say, with a waiting time of delta t. And this waiting time, we express it in a relativistically invariant way, saying that take the time-like distance this being equal to this randomly generated value of the waiting time, and that will be such a hyperboloid, which we call ht of x. A hyperboloid with waiting time, or time-like distance t of x0. Now, so we construct such hyperboloids of constant time-like distance to all of our flashes. And these waiting times are random. All right. And third, we will determine the next generation of flashes on these space-like surfaces given by these flashes. Maybe also, I guess I should maybe draw the picture so you can bear with me better. So we will start with like n flashes, and we will construct certain hyperboloids. Maybe they are all a little bit different. So with all kinds of different waiting times, delta t1, delta t2, and so on. And then we will generate new flashes somewhere on these surfaces according to a process which I described now. We'll do that again randomly and with a probability given by this formula here. Here is this missing L. Should be yn element d sigma n. And according to a certain probability density, and that probability density is given by the following formula here. We essentially take the probability density we had before and multiply it by certain factors. And then we will be, we can convolute it with certain factors. These factors will be Gaussians. And we do that with this convolution with respect to each of these hyperboloids. And the object that you convolve is the density. These weight factors here, with respect to which we take a convolution, and they depend on a space-like surface. And what we essentially want to say is that we have a Gaussian on the surface. But to say that it's a little bit more complicated in a relativistic setting, so this will depend on the surface. And what we do is to take the space-like distance of two points on a surface. So instead of taking just the spatial distance, we take the space-like distance along our certain hyperplane. So to have a relativistic notion of distance on that hyperplane, hyper surface. So it is to kind of formulate in simpler terms a covariant normalized Gaussian on sigma. Okay, then we will randomly determine these new flashes that will be somewhere on these surfaces. And then we also collapse the wave function with collapse centers according to these new flashes. So according to this process, the new flashes are these y1 to yn. So we will have then the randomly determined sum by y1. So this was the x1. So we get a y1 here. That was the x2. We will maybe get a y2 here, and so on. Yeah. And then we collapse the wave function in each of these factors with these covariant options, and have a new y wave function phi prime in that way. And this phi prime we first have only on the cross product of these surfaces. We don't have it everywhere in space time. I mean, kind of up to there, when we imagine that the previous wave function. And then we have it on the surface, but then we can, like, from that surface on, we can just extend it again using the master time wave function, the whole of space time, or at least to the future, and therefore have a new wave function everywhere on configuration space time. We can repeat the whole process. So after first step, we have new flashes, and then we, like, step by step, we set up this galaxy of flashes according to that law. All right.
I don't know if you have time or if you consider Einstein boxes with BR and pointer here and pointer here, can you show how it works? Because BR works. You say it's covariant. You have this long distance places and then there is superposition here and here. And then there is an action or there is no action. I can measure this or not measure.
Yeah.
The fact that I'll measure will create all kind of flashes and will kind of kill the wave function or create.
That's right.
So the flashes on the other side are supposed to change immediately.
Mm-hmm.
So it doesn't look covariant.
But I think this is not really a problem with covariance. It's just there would be a kind of fact in nature when exactly this happened, and a kind of covariant facts you can simply put in terms of events when this thing
you
goes
can
on.
Change if you have action at the distance. It's hard to say it's hard.
But this is not, it's two different things. Like something can be covariant and still have action at the distance. But in GLW theory, it's also not exactly action at distance because it's not like an agent can really, like, do something to the.
An agent can measure or not measure. And this, it will change.
But it will kind of randomly.
What?
So the kind of fact about this non-locality is generated still randomly. It's not like one pulse, the other.
So randomly, it will, you know, if I find a particle here, I will not find a particle here. But clearly, with very high probability, the half wave will not leave, stay on the other side.
Yeah.
It will be either a zero or the whole wave. So if I decide that shortly after I will make a measurement on the other side, then my action.
Maybe we can draw a little picture about the situation that everyone can understand.
Yeah.
So you think about a certain region.
So far away on the left,
yeah.
I have one half a particle, and half a wave on the right, I have another half.
Yeah, I wonder how to best draw that, perhaps on...
Just about here, but this is X, yes. This is X.
So maybe you imagine you have two space-like separated
regions.
Yes,
yes, very far. So, and then, if you don't do anything, then the flashes on the right will be very slow. There is some probability of these flashes.
Mm-hmm.
Or you can decide that you can measure shortly after on the right.
Yeah, that would just also mean like to include something in a larger system.
So yes, because in the moment you couple these things to the measuring device, then you will make flashes. Flashes happen for all of them, so necessarily.
So then flashes will happen, and then basically.
So compare to the situation. You make a measurement on the left, or you don't make a measurement on the left, and I say situation on the right side will be different.
Yeah, so that there's a form of non-locality, but still it's a
combination.
Covariance
and non-locality, so I'm not sure that what's covariant.
So I don't see any objection to covariance. Would you say it seems to just
covariance should fulfill relativistic covariance.
Maybe I could.
Because
the following remark is helpful.
Yes.
So there are flashes, there are points in space-time, and points in space-time are points in space-time. They transform according to Lorentz transformation. Now, what the wave function does is a more complicated business. So in this kind of theory, you would associate a different wave function with every space-like hypersurface. And you would do it in the following way. Suppose there's a flash here. Okay? Now you can consider different surfaces. Some of these surfaces, sigma, are before the flash, some are after the flash. Now, the evolution of the wave function, now consider a family of surfaces. You push that towards the future. For each of these surfaces, you have a wave function. Now, whenever the surface crosses a flash, the wave function collapses. Okay, so now if you have flashes over here, then some surfaces have already passed this flash and not the other one. Some surfaces have passed the other one and not this one. Now the instantaneity of the collapse means that you take some surface that goes through all of the universe, it crosses one flash here, it collapses everywhere in the universe on this surface. Then you ask, okay, but at this point, has it collapsed or not collapsed? Well, it depends on which surface you're looking at. Are you looking at this surface or that surface?
I mean,
keep that in mind.
No, I understand all this, but I ask a different question. I think what's relevant here and what was discussion before about all this kind of type of action at a distance in different interpretation. That the action at a distance, there is kind of disturbance on one side, what will happen there? So I understand when we discussed in the trail, you said that it's this for one moment, that on flashes it doesn't work. And I say it looks like it does work. Because if you have this superposition, and you have one case, and there's no disturbance, no one can do anything to, and don't do measure. And another case, one make measurement on A, which kind of forces existence of many flashes and forces the GLW collapse of this system. Then on B, there will be difference. After this forcing, so this is kind of a relatively short time event. You put very big pointer, collapse happens very fast. After the collapse, situation in B will be different. So this pattern of flashes is different if you measure A or you don't measure A. So
wait, you can't say the pattern of flashes is different. You affect the probabilities. What do you mean the pattern of flashes is different?
No, the pattern in the sense that this.
So these flashes are kind of nature chooses them randomly. Okay, so.
But after you found it here, the flashes there will not happen.
Yes, exactly.
So, before that they could have. So it's
a type of non-locality about nothing.
Covariance
is something else. It's just that these are really just space-time events. Like they're like galaxy of space-time events which are completely transformable red covariant waves. So that's kind of clearly called covariant. It's still non-local, as you say.
I saw the language. Everyone says that we have quantum, non-relativistic quantum mechanics is not covariant, so it's really, you can send signals faster than light. If you have relativistic quantum mechanics, it is covariant, you cannot send signals faster than light. The covariance for me is relativistic causality. So
but
you cannot send signals, but in the branch which you found, there is a change, so the description changes faster than light.
Yeah, so maybe we have to talk about that again later. Okay,
this process where you generate the flashes is now illustrated a little bit more, because I guess I did that on the blackboard already. But so for one particle, you would see you would start with something, take the hyperboloid, and randomly get a new flash. Then the wave function, of course, is not shown, but the collapse is there. Then you determine again like the random waiting time in a covariant way that kind of determines new probability. According to the collapse wave function, you determine then the probabilities that generate a new flash and so on. No? So that's the way this instruction process works. And for n, it kind of works simultaneously for n, and also in a non-local way. So the status of non-locality is that it is inherent in the construction process. Nature randomly determines a joint and non-locally correlated distribution of flashes. However, there is no fact about which flash determines which. The status with respect to relativity is there is no preferred space-time structure necessary to implement the non-locality. So you could say, you kind of reconcile non-locality completely with relativity. Okay, now we come to Bohmian, relativistic Bohmian mechanics. I will present here a model that's called the hypersurface Bohm-Dirac model. Yes?
If we have a question about the Fourier chapter, should we have them now?
Maybe that would be a good point.
I wanted to know how can we identify flashes, like in the picture just that you showed just before. It's like it's always the same flash, but how can you know that it's the same?
You will never know. There is no identity or persistence of objects in this theory.
This is just a view of mine.
Mm-hmm. So you can say this is like a successor of that. So you kind of construct your own theory about like this looks like, for example, maybe a single particle traveling, but maybe you could also see it in different ways. But the theory says these are the only things that are there. So simply you have to live with that picture of the world. Perhaps it's like a little bit, you have to get used to this picture, also the fact that sometimes there's nothing in space time. Yeah, so there's certainly no consistency of objects.
Yeah.
Then in that case, how do we distinguish between different particles? You say that it might be a particle going from down to top, bottom to top, or it might be something else. So.
You cannot really in principle do that. Sometimes you would be inclined to call that a particle traveling from here to there in ordinary language. That would really be there, so kind of many flashes here, there. And then on the other side, very far away, maybe it would be also like something like that. But it's really like kind of arbitrary to call them a particle traveling from here to there or from there to there. I think it really could come to that only like if you look at kind of bigger systems and how they behave. For example, if a particle detector modeled in the same theory and it behaves like a particle detector, you think, yeah, okay, well, these things that it interacts with are particles. That's a good point. The world is a little bit strange in that theory, perhaps. Certainly unfamiliar. Are there more questions? Then I come now to the relativistic Bohmian model. So the basic idea here is to write down a Lorentz covariant law for the actual world lines of particles, and that law is based on a multi-time wave function. The main ingredients are first, again, covariant law for a multi-time wave function, for example, these three multi-time Dirac equations. And the second ingredient is a preferred foliation of space-time into space-like hypersurfaces, sigma s, s and r, which has a normal vector field of the foliation n of x. I should illustrate it a little bit. So, to have a foliation of space-time means that if you have space-time here, that you decompose that into set of space-like surfaces that can be curved in a certain way, so that the union of these surfaces gives the whole space-time, and then each, you basically can have a parameter s equals 0, s equals 1, a continuous parameter which parameterizes this family of hypersurfaces. I think you get the picture. So each frame would, for example, do that by just giving all of the equal time surfaces in that frame, but also could be curved.
Yes. In this family, they don't intersect, so the idea is that we really have...
I think you could also sometimes consider some where they intersect.
Okay.
Sometimes it could lead to technical problems, but it's not a big deal for that.
But then the question, in an intersection, are the values as a set?
The values of the multi-wave function will all automatically be the same, since it's just an object on space time to the n, so they will be the same.
There's no local value. I understand in all this picture, you go locally to some point. There's some local.
Maybe I can say it like that. So So you give something precise, but what is the same is if you have the wave function. And if you look at that restricted on one space like surface sigma to the n. We imagine two surfaces which are intersect in a certain part, let's say sigma and sigma prime. They're like up to here, they just intersect, then they're different. Then what we'll have that the intersect will be validated by Q. That Q, which is in this intersection, as well, Q is in the, as well, of course it's in the n form product, then that will be by just the fact that this is a Morse sine wave function will be the same as if you evaluate it in sigma prime and at the same Q. There's a point in there's a Q there's a point in sigma to the n intersected with sigma prime.
It's position in space time.
So sometimes the wave functions will be objective values in space time. Yeah. It is not really hypersurface dependent. It's only dependent on these points. Okay. So I will say a lot more about the space time, but just let me explain how this law works. But you use such a preferred variation of space time. And then, given these things, it gives you a law for the world lines. And it looks as follows. So maybe I'll just like draw a picture for, well, I'll actually have a picture on the slide, so maybe I'll first explain the mathematical form, then explain what this picture looks like. For each particle, you specify how that particle's world line, so the four vector considered for each particle, is parameterized by a certain parameter. This parameter is always the same. I choose it here to be the one of the foliation. And sometimes you can say this parameter plays the role of absolute time in a certain way with respect to that foliation. And the change of the world line in that parameter is given by you take this tensor current and contract away all indices except for the k one, which is the one of that particle which you're looking at. And you project it with all the normal vectors at the foliation. And then this thing, you have to still like an n open slots. They need to be evaluated somewhere, and you evaluate them at the simultaneous configuration of all the other particles, and where simultaneity is here defined by the foliation. So now it comes the, well, okay, the picture is still not there. Maybe I draw it at this point. So let's look at, let's say, the world line of particle xk. So this is the world line of particle xk. And then you will have a law for n such world lines. Sorry, there's just a 2 here. And if you want to know the change at a certain value of s in that world line, all you need to do is look at where the other particles on that foliation, how the normal vector field is at that foliation. And put that in the law here. And evaluate that tensor current contracted with the normal vector at that point. Then you will know the change in that world line. So how that for the next little change will look like. And the other way around. All right, so now I can say a few things about this law.
Sorry?
Yeah?
But in this context, if they intersect, then one particle could be somehow on two foliations, and would it then be the problem that it's not unique? Where, on which?
No, I think you do need to consider such cases in separately in the theory of the existing uniqueness,
okay.
But it's not a problem.
It's not a problem.
I think Rogi has a paper about it in special cases together with Wallace-Trojan. If you consider kind of more complicated foliations, relations with kings, then what happens then? As far as I understand, it's not a problem. Or maybe Rogi, can you say something about that?
It's not a problem, you can do that, but don't worry about it. It's a better for today, it's better to think of a foliation where they don't intersect.
Okay. All right. So what is law? You can let them just note a few properties, so few important properties. The first is the Lorentz invariance. If the foliation itself obeys a Lorentz invariant law, then the trajectories will be Lorentz invariant. I will say something about these laws. Then you have equivariance on the foliation. That means if you start with the initial distribution of points on a certain surface of that foliation that is psi square distributed, where psi square now means this rho sigma, this rho sigma distributed, then it will stay a rho sigma distributed also later if you just follow these initial positions according to their Bohmian paths. So, and the statistical distribution flows in the correct way with that Bohmian velocity vector field. But this will only be true not on all surfaces and space-time, but only on those of the foliation. Yeah, so do you have a question?
If I'm in a rocket and go far and very fast and I kind of want to understand what's happening in my T0 T-constant, surface. I'm forced to only think about this foliation. I have another foliation. The present in my rocket. I don't have a description. Or what should I do?
So in general, I mean, your rest frame will not correspond to that foliation.
Yes. So then.
Still, what turns out by the analysis, the theory. So then, first of all, you have no kind of primitive state in order to distribution. But still true is that if you perform any measurement in your frame, then measurement means you're getting these facts about the recordings with more persist. And you can just wait until you pass the surface of that foliation again. And then you will know that by the equivariance on that foliation, the results will just be given by the psi square distribution also. So then the consistency for the quantum prediction is ensured in measurements. But it won't be your rest frame, which is actually the unmeasured distribution of trajectories is psi square distributed in general. All right.
That makes no local measurement in points in different foliations. So if I had a simple recipe, what to do? How to predict what I will get?
I think I don't have a simple recipe like my friend right wing. But I think you will be there. So this consideration that I just gave will kind of allow you to use psi square distribution to calculate the results. But that's what you would do otherwise anyway. Okay, so it's important to say that primitively this equivariance will only hold on the equal foliation, will not hold on other surfaces. But still, in measurements, you will get the, according to that reason that like, basically gave us the answer to Lab's question, you'll still get psi square distributed results in measurements. So that means that the foliation is actually unobservable. You can't find out by doing statistical experiments what the foliation is. Even though still the trajectories will depend on which foliation you have. Okay, now there's a lot more comments appropriate about the foliation. This F foliation is a structure which you need to use in addition to space-time, but it's not directly in conflict with relativity or with the space-time. It doesn't deny anything, but any kind of statement in relativity, but it adds something to it. Then another interesting fact is that Rudy usually likes to point out is that there are space-times which have natural foliations. For example, in case the space-time has a Big Bang singularity, the beginning of the universe, then we can take as our foliation those surfaces with constant time-like distance to the Big Bang. So to say, the surfaces where you have the a certain age, a certain time since the beginning of the universe has passed, and time like in the sense of time like distance or real time in a overwhelming way. Another important, but this is not the only class still of natural foliation. There are some other natural foliation that is interesting foliation to consider. Been advocated a lot by Dürr, Goldstein, Sandy, Struve. Namely, one can extract laws for the foliation from the wave function itself. For example, you can do something like taking the average of the energy momentum tensor, and you get a kind of two component tensor real object, and you can like again integrate that over any space like surface, but the space like surface won't matter because of conservation law, and that way you get a kind of time like vector field, and that could be that vector field which gives you these directions, and in many cases you would be able to construct the foliation from that. So yeah.
Would you be able to draw some steps? Like, I was struggling to follow a bit.
Okay. Let's say your theory that you're looking at as an energy momentum operator. Yeah. So you can take the expectation value of that operator. So I guess this would be the Heisenberg state, or the amount of time state. And then you could integrate that thing over any space-like surface. And since this given new object will satisfy a continuity equation also in the index. And by that fact, in Gauss's theorem, the divergence theorem, will be independent actually of that surface sigma. So you can find a kind of sigma-independent vector, and actually in terms of time-like vector, p mu x. And then you could normalize, and that could give you a normal vector field. As a normal vector field, then you're looking at that. And then you could kind of integrate that normal vector field and give you a foliation.
I think the index should be nu on the left-hand side.
Oh, yes. Uh-huh. Oh, thank you. So this is just an example for a certain class of laws you could actually construct from the wave function. And I guess we should here take the wave function of the universe. But in any case, so the wave function bears a lot of structure in it, and it can be used to extract foliation from it, of course in many different ways. Still, in my opinion, this is a somewhat kind of sore point of the story. It's unclear which foliation one should choose. But I guess both to comfort or maybe worry you is like all foliations will still lead to the same statistics and measurements, though not to the same trajectories. But it's kind of both a good thing and a bad thing. So a good thing because the statistics will come out right, and a bad thing you can never know what the kind of real trajectories will actually be. Even though there will be a fact in such a theory, will be a fact about the trajectories that is foliation dependent. Another interesting idea we can have is why should we not use light cones instead of as a foliation? So the light cones could still be used to say like what should I plug into the wave function to kind of see it and record at the same time. That would be a little bit kind of more relativistic structure instead of a simultaneity surface. That you could do, but we would have to use future light cones in order to have any non-locality in this law. You see, we need to kind of somehow get Bell's inequalities violated. We need to have non-locality. If you do surpass light cones, we won't have it. So we'd have to use future light cones. And that would actually be a non-local theory with broad lines. But then it would not be clear how that law would not have an invariance problem. And would consequently not be clear how to do to get back any quantum statistics from it. But the empirical content of that law would be unclear. So that's another role of foliation. It has two roles. It has the role of conveying the non-locality, and has this light cone also could take over, but it also has the other role of making a statistical analysis possible that it will agree with the quantum predictions. And that role cannot be taken over so easily by light cones. Maybe a different statistical analysis would be needed, but it's not clear whether something like that exists.
Are you aware of Helvin Krauss model? It's not a bomb, but it's a collapse on light cones.
Mm-hmm.
So it's, in principle, it's statistically covariant. It's strange, but.
Yeah.
So you say that light cone cannot make.
Yeah, light cones would make it covariant on non-local, but the statistical analysis, the question of how you would get these bombing trajectories to have their distribution somehow according to psi square would be unclear. There's no real immediate reason you can see in this law why that would be so. Maybe it would not be so.
So
all right. So more about the non-locality. But this law, as bombing mechanics in general, is explicitly non-local, and the non-locality is instantaneous along the surfaces of the foliation. Still, nothing needs to travel between these particles to convey this influence. The law is simply made such that a particle here will influence something there in a non-local way. Also, this non-locality cannot be used for supraluminal signaling. That is just as a non-relativistic quantum mechanics that can't be done. And the reason essentially that you have no control over the initial conditions. If you did, then you could have non-local signals. But you have no control over the initial conditions. Okay, then let me also compare the GRWF model and the Eichersholz Bohm-Dirac model a little bit, and maybe also the many worlds interpretation. So this relativistic many worlds model and the relativistic GRWF model, they both did not need a foliation. For the GRWF, the reason, or one reason for that it doesn't need that, is that as a stochastic theory, it does not need to specify how the non-locality is conveyed. So it's simply like nature just generates this non-locality randomly in a correlated way for distant flashes. In Bohmian theory, someone needs to say how these influences are conveyed. And they are in this model conveyed by an instantaneous influence along the foliation. This difference can be pinpointed by following more abstract criteria. So people often talk about this type of criteria, namely microscopic parameter independence. Let A and B be space-like separated regions in the future of a space-like hypersurface sigma zero. Maybe again, the picture is appropriate. So we have some sigma zero, and we have A and B. Then for given initial conditions on sigma zero, the choice of different external fields in B here has no influence on the distribution of the primitive ontology in A. So that is something that GRWF respects, but the hypersurface Bohm-Dirac model violates. And this is a certain aspect of control or like action at a distance. You have in the Bohmian model, but don't have in the same way in the GRWF model. All right. So I guess there's still a lot of positive questions remaining, but let me conclude here and then we can maybe discuss more. We saw that multi-time wave functions are a useful concept to define both Lorentz covariance laws for the primitive ontology. actually also a natural guess for the distribution of rho sigma along space-like surfaces. And then, precise versions of quantum theory show that non-locality can be fully compatible with relativity. So especially, we can see that, I think there's a little doubt in the Manigault interpretation, and in so as far as that works. And also in the GWF. In the case of the hypersurface Bohm-Dirac model, the determinism, I mean, for a single world, makes it difficult to express non-locality without a foliation, at least if the quantum statistics should come out right. And whether the hypersurface Bohm-Dirac model can be accepted as relativistic, finally depends on the definition of relativistic. Lorentz invariant is satisfied, it's just something to prove mathematically for that model. But additional space-time structure is used. Of course, one can argue, and has been argued, that in a sense the space-time structure exists already in the case, for example, that space-time has a natural foliation, and also in the sense that wave functions contain the structure, you're just extracted from that. But still, it requires the choice of a law to actually extract that and to really postulate this foliation exists, is really used, I mean, opposed to just kind of being there in a purely mathematical way. And the hypersurface Bohm-Dirac model uses it in an essential way. So, to the extent that such a foliation can be accepted as relativistic, also the current Bohmian models are relativistic. Anything, what kind of really say so much more about it? One could maybe hope that light cone models could be developed more, but at the moment there are really no good clues to how to do that. And also would require visual causality, so some people might find that kind of a problematic feature. It would certainly come with other questions. But with that, I would also like to come to the end now and open up the discussion. Yes?
I was wondering, how do you find space-time within wave functions? You mentioned that in your conclusion, that in some ways that space-time structures can exist within the wave functions.
Yeah.
But I thought the whole point of Bohm's theory was that you have space-time external to the wave function on which the wave function is embedded on. Isn't that...
No, it is the foliation which is determined by the wave function.
Not the space-time itself, just the foliation.
Okay.
So I mean, it's a bit complicated. How it works.
So it's the foliation that you're driving from.
So you have kind of the space-time, then you can solve the multi-time equation on that space-time. And then that wave function which you get will determine a foliation on the space-time again, which is then be used to compute define the form of the trajectories.
Yeah.
But of course this is now I present this in a step-by-step way, of course when it comes all at once. So basically the model is defined just all at once in one go.
Okay.
Yes?
I don't understand like how the how non-locality is going to work for the when we are foliating this hypersurface we have divided the n manifold into like pieces, different linear pieces like which are continuous and differentiable. I don't know whether they are not or not. So in that case when we had cut them into different pieces, how the non-locality is going to work in that case.
Then it's actually more
and
simple.
Because there
to
was
explain.
A statement
yeah,
about
yeah.
the...
Let me explain. It's actually more simple. Simply, if you are essentially one of these surfaces, you want to know in the particle A how that will move in the next instant of time, and then you have to kind of look on that surface where all the other particles are on that surface, and there behavior will influence, and also the curvature of that of the surface at that point will influence how that one particle will move. So in the kind of most straightforward way, that can, the non-relativistic quantum mechanics, you look at what are the other particles doing at that very time. Now you look at replace time by on that surface.
When we consider non-relativity, is it that we try to integrate the whole surface and then, because would it cause problem, like, since we have different pieces?
No, they all have to look smoothly fit together to form, form the whole space-time.
The elements of the foliation.
Mm-hmm. That's what a foliation means, like, to lay it back in. It, like, its union will give you back the space-time.
But how can we have joined existence since they don't have any in common?
Well, why not? I mean, they have to have kind of existence in a block universe, so to say.
Yeah, but a block universe is just a representation. I mean, in the
a lot of people in relativity would say that's how the universe is. It just exists in the past, the future, extended as it is.
I have another question, actually.
But actually, this foliation fits almost not so badly with presentism, if you want that. Simply, like, presence is simply defined relative to the foliation. Simply, how you go through time is just S is now your time. The parameter of this foliation is now your time.
But you know it's not like that, because what you observe, you know it's not in present. So, how can in the presentism idea, how can the foliation have joint existence, because you know I do not understand what is more than an artificial gathering of different moments that are separated in the same time.
Well, in this case, it plays a role also for the law of motion. So it has a more meaning than that, and also you could just like how you're going to represent the fact that the distance. What you would count as being at the same instance of time, you just use that to define what's at that same instance of time, and you justify it in that because it plays a role in the law of motion. Yeah.
I think you mentioned the universal wave function in the context of Hoyle wave theory before, and I had this question on Monday as well, and I still don't think this is an answer. So if you have a universal wave function, how do you satisfy the Wheeler-DeWitt equation and at the same time have time evolution?
Okay, so, well, first of all, I don't think really in this, for these toy models about the Wheeler-DeWitt equation. I'm also not sure whether it's really a good idea, the Wheeler-DeWitt equation. As far as I know, it's just a kind of proposal which is like so no empirical consequences or so. So it's not so clear that you would need that. But let's say like you want it, and then first of all, it's still not really something from matter. I was talking about matter models, the Wheeler-DeWitt equation. Pure empty gravity. Okay, but still, that set aside, if you have the universal wave function, it's time independent, it's still the Bohmian configuration could be time dependent, and by that, we could create actually a time dependent wave function for subsystems. So, and then they could satisfy time dependent equations again.
I'm not sure if I follow. You still wouldn't have like an actual time dependence, right? Like,
but yeah, the universal wave function, as you said, like, would not have
yeah.
time.
So it would just be the subsystems within that.
Mm-hmm. There you go. So basically, the question is at which level the Schrödinger equation, which is the time dependent, would be appropriate, maybe only at the level of subsystems. But this is just an idea. It doesn't have to be like that. It could also be that Schrödinger equation is just. Or time-dependent equation is appropriate always, but I mean, we don't know, right? I mean, here just take some law, some very simple law to just discuss this model. It's going to feel what you're talking about. I'm not talking about a little bit of this. Yes?
I don't understand how you can read a condition without a big line for a reference. How do you know? Is it just arbitrary?
No, so
how do you know which like particular moments and places you choose to make your foliation?
Those which have like the equal, write down just the definition. So the collection of all those surfaces sigma s each sigma is a set of space-time points such that the distance of x to the Big Bang point, the Big Bang singularity, the time-like distance I'm moving here.
Yeah, but I mean, without the Big Bang.
Equal to s.
With the Big Bang, it's very clear, but without the Big Bang.
Oh, okay, then you don't have this type of foliation.
Oh, okay, so it's, what type is it then?
Anyway, but it's not a unique foliation you could choose.
Okay,
there are certain arguments for naturalness. And perhaps in these other cases, you could do something extracted from the wave function, for example, such a law. But there would be many laws if you would see natural to different people. But not so clear which one nature would have chosen, or if any. But to set up such a model, you would know to make a choice.
Maybe I can add one last question.
Why do we need the foliation for that hypersurface sigma? Is that it possible? Like we can directly define it to be differentiable and continuous, like between certain limits that we are considering.
And you need to kind of say like the Bohmian law is always something like what happens to one particle depends on the wave function and where all the other particles are. And the same where all the other particles are, you need to sit. You need to specify something in the foliation and doesn't have to be the same.
If
you put in simultaneous configurations. Yeah, the simultaneous configurations are simultaneous being defined by the foliation. As I said, I mean you don't necessarily need a foliation to do that particular job. I mean for example light cones, future light cones would do as well, but then there would be other issues. The foliation also gives you equivariance. It just does these two jobs. So far, it's not been kind of research or any other structure to do both these roles, could satisfy both these roles.
So maybe let's interrupt here for the coffee break. And before we thank Matthias again, let me say this. If you haven't picked up your certificate yet, please come to the front. I will give you your certificate. Thank you again.